Good morning, students. Today we are going to see the revision as an electrostatics. As already we have seen that electrostatics till the characteristics of the charges. Now we are going to continue. The next one is what? The very important topic is Coulomb's law. The next important topic is Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law is used to find out the force between the two charges. Let us assume these are the two charges. This is Q1, and let me take this is Q2, and the distance between the two charges, let me take it as R. Coulomb found that the force between the two charges, it may be attractive force or it may be a repulsive force, depends on the nature of the charges. Correct? If the charges are like, then it may be attractive force. If there are these two charges are unlike charges, then it may be a repulsive force. Okay, so the force may be attractive or repulsive, it depends on the like or unlike charges. The force directly proportional to the product of two charges, that means we can say F directly proportional to Q1 and Q2, and the force inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the two charges, that you can take it as 1 by R square. So by combining these two equations, you can write it as F is equal to K into Q1 Q2 by R square. The K is known as the proportionality constant, and the value of K is given by K is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Okay, here the epsilon naught is known as permittivity of free space. And the value of epsilon naught is given by epsilon naught is equal to 8.854 into 10 power minus 12 Coulomb square, Newton raised to minus 1, meter raised to minus 2. That is the unit of epsilon naught, and this is the value magnitude, and this is the unit. So it is very simple to know the unit. So don't memorize the unit. You know that F can be written now, instead of the K, I can use it as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 and Q2 by R square. So, the epsilon naught can be written as 1 by 4 pi F into Q1 and Q2 by R square. Now you substitute all the units. This Coulomb, again the Q2 for one more Coulomb, 4 pi is constant. Force Newton and R meter square, that means Coulomb square, Newton raised to minus 1, meter raised to minus 2, that one they written here. So that is the unit of what, not a permittivity. Here we no need to memorize the unit, just you can, and this is the magnitude, 8.854 to 10 power minus 12. And the proportionality symbol, here you substitute all the values, then what you get, 1 by 4 into the pi can be written as 3.14 into the epsilon naught value. Again, if you substitute here, you will be getting 8.854 into 10 power minus 12. If you do that, you will be getting 9 into 10 power 9 Newton meter square Coulomb raised to minus 2. That is the unit for another. This 9 into 10 power 9 Newton meter square, that is the value of K. K is equal to 9 into 10 power minus 9, and this will be coming up, that means you take the reciprocal of this unit. So Newton meter square Coulomb raised to minus 2. So that is the value of K. That is the value of K. So we could be able to calculate the value of epsilon naught and the value of K. Here we use the word as permittivity. Actually, what is mean by permittivity? It is explained here itself. Permittivity You might have learned in 10th standard, if you are taking a magnet, this is the north and south. The magnetic field is represented by magnetic field lines. It starts from north to south outside and south to north inside. Similarly here also, north to south outside and south to north inside. So the magnetic field is represented by magnetic lines of force. Similarly, the electric field is represented by electric lines of force. So the ability, permittivity, permit, or the ability to allow the electric lines of force through the medium, that means here we are taking air or free space, that we can call it as permittivity. Understood, Nada? Suppose let us assume that both the charges are going to be placed in a medium. That means we are going to take a bucket of water, okay? It's completely filled with water. I'm going to keep the charge Q1 here and the charge Q2 here, but both are having again separated by the same distance. Now the force is written as Fm. The M indicates that the force between the two charge placed inside the medium. So Fm will be equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon, not epsilon naught. Epsilon naught is permittivity of free space or air. But epsilon is the permittivity of medium. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon into Q1 Q2 by R square. The epsilon value will be equal to epsilon naught into epsilon R. The epsilon R is known as relative permittivity, that we can call it as a relative permittivity. It's a number. The epsilon R is a number. Actually, the epsilon R is equal to 1 for air. The epsilon R is equal to 80 for water. And the epsilon R is equal to infinity for metal. What does it matter? But the epsilon R never be less than 1. It has minimum value for air or free space. For air or free space, the value will be equal to 1. If it is water, the value will be taken as 80. If it is a metal, the value will be taken as what? Infinity. Understood, na? So now, let us calculate the force between the two particles inside a metal. Let me assume that it's a metal, iron. Here one charge is there, Q1. Here another one charge is there, Q2. Both are separated by distance. Now, Fm is equal to, what is the formula? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into epsilon r Q1 Q2 by R square. The epsilon r is what? Infinity. So this value will become 1 by infinity, that is equal to 0. So what is the meaning of the statement? Force will be equal to 0. That means when two charged particles place inside the metal, they never experience a force. The real meaning of that, the charge can move as their wish. It can move like what now? Drunker motion, you know that. The people, those who have consumed alcohol, cannot able to walk out. Na? First step you'll keep here, second step you'll keep here, third here, fourth here. How will walk? Nobody. Like that, the charges can move what not? On the surface of the metal in any direction. That otherwise we can call it as, the particle will execute random motion. They will execute what nama? Random motion. Understood? So these are about what na? The Coulomb's law. Do you have any doubts? If you have doubt, you can message me or you can call me also, no problem. So now let us move on to the next topic. So now, for air, the force is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 Q2 by R square. For medium, the force is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 Q2 by R square. But additionally, here one more thing will come. There is nothing but epsilon R. Now, let me take it as FA. Let us take FA by FM. FA by FM. So FA means, again is substitute the value, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 Q2 by R square. This you can take the reciprocal, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into epsilon naught R square divided by Q1 Q2. So this Q1 Q2 and this Q1 Q2 cancel, this R square cancel. And this 4 pi, this 4 pi epsilon, epsilon, everything is cancelled. That means FA by FM is equal to epsilon R. That otherwise can be written as epsilon by epsilon naught. So this is the formula for the force. FA by FM will be equal to epsilon R, or you can write as otherwise epsilon by epsilon naught. Okay. So this is an important relation. Capacitor, we have learned the same relation, but in capacitor under Cm by Ca is equal to epsilon R. But here FA by FM is equal to epsilon R. Understand? So these are the applications of what na this Coulomb's law. Now the Coulomb, can the Coulomb's law applicable for only one system? No. It obeys the superposition principle. So now let us take Coulomb's law for a system of charges. Okay. So let me take this is x-axis and this is y-axis. There are two objects. First, let me take two particle system in vector form. Here, the charge Q1. Here, one more charge is there. That let me take it as Q2. This distance you can take it as R1 from the origin. This distance you take it as R2. This distance will be R12. If you take this distance, that is equal to R21. What is the meaning of R12? Distance of the first charge from the second. R21 means distance of the second charge from the first one. Okay. So these two are like charges. Let us assume that both are like. So due to the second charge, there is a force exists on the first one, that you can take it as F12. They repel, so that will be acting in this direction. Similarly, the Q2 will experience another one force, that you can take it as F21. Force on the first, due to what? Force on the second due to the first charge. That's another. So first let me find out F12 vector, that is equal to K Q1 Q2 divided by R12 square in the R12 cap. Where this value gives the magnitude and this gives the direction. Similarly, F21 vector is equal to K into Q1 Q2 divided by R21 square into R21 cap. But this magnitude of R12 is equal to magnitude of R21. Both are having the same magnitude, but the direction is different. So you can write R12 cap. But R12 cap is equal to minus R21 cap. Both are having but not the same magnitude, but acting in the different direction. That means you can write F12 vector is equal to minus F21 vector. Both are equal in magnitude. Both the vectors are equal in magnitude, but both are acting in the opposite direction. So now the next question, if two forces are equal and opposite, can we consider this as an action-reaction pair? Yes, we can consider this as what not an action-reaction pair, because they are not acting on the same object. F12 acting on the first charge, F21 acting on the second charge. If two forces acting on the different charges, two forces acting on the different charges, If they have the same magnitude and direction, then it can be considered as a action reaction pair. So we can consider here the two vectors F12 and F21 are action reaction pair. So they obeys the Newton's third law of motion. They obeys what now? Newton's third law of motion. Sure na? So now here we have discussed about the vector form of this thing for a two particle system. Now let me take it as for a three particle. If there are so many charges, let me take this as origin. Here one charge, that let me take it as Q1. Sorry, Q2. Here one charge, that let me take it as Q1. Here one more charge, that let me take it as Q3. So there are two forces acting on the charge Q1. Due to the charge Q2, there is a force. Let us assume all are positive charge. So there is a force acting, that will be acting this. This is the force F12. The force, the direction of the force, see, that is very, very important. The direction of force always lie on the line joining the two masses or the two charges, the center of mass of the two charges. The force always lie on the line joining the center of masses of the two charges. So it will be acting towards whatever only either that direction or in the downward direction. Okay. So let me take here the line joining will be acting here. So this force will be acting here. That you can take it as F13. So now the resultant. So now if you want to find out the resultant, again you have to go with the parallelogram law of vector addition. These two vectors are represented by the two sides of the parallelogram. So let me draw the parallelogram. And so the resultant gives the F1 vector. That means here the F1 vector is equal to F12 vector plus what not a F13 vectors for n charges. Means you can write F1 vector is equal to F12 vector plus F13 plus F14 ... So this indicates the superposition here. Now one more important thing we have to consider here. If you want to take or if you want to find out the force on the charge Q1, then here two forces F13 and F12. But you can ask one more question to me. Sir, these two charges also experience some force. Maybe there is an attractive or a repulsive force, depends on the nature of these two charges. But if you want to calculate the force on the first charge, the remaining force will be neglected. So we no need to worry about the interaction between the other charges. We should consider only the interaction of the charges with the first one, Q1 alone. We don't need to worry about what now? Other charges. That is the main consideration here we have to follow. Okay. Now, let us move on to the next thing. The next one is electric field. The force gets over. Now, let us move on to the next thing. That is nothing but what now? Electric field. What is mean by electric field? Denoted by the letter E vector, it's a vector quantity. So what is meant by electric field? Electric field nothing but the region. For example, let me take this is the region. This is the charge Q. There is a region around the charge. Here only it can able to experience the force of attraction or repulsion. That region only we can call it as what not a electric field. The region or the space around the charge where it can experience either an attractive force or a repulsive force, that region we can call it as what not a electric field or the space around the charge. It's a three-dimensional, but here I cannot, that means it's a sphere, but here I cannot able to note it. That is the reason it is what not a represented by a circle, but it's a three-dimensional. And it has spherical symmetry. What is the meaning of spherical symmetry? Spherical symmetry means what not a, if you are going to take a charge, means the charge is at the center. From that, let me take a distance r. If you draw your sphere, all the parts, that means all the parts of the sphere, the value of E will be same. That means it has spherical symmetry. This side, this side, or this side, or this side. Any direction. from the charge, if we find, if the distance is constant, the value of E will be constant. That means the electric field has what not a spherical symmetry. So now, let me ask one more question. Now, the field exists or not around this charge, can you able to find out? We cannot able to find out by using our NAC type, correct? Not? So, if the field is exist or not, if you want to find out, we have to bring one more charge. Let me bring one more charge. If I keep the charge here, it will never experience a force. Now, if I bring the charge at this position, now it will experience a force. Correct? No? That means, when the charge brought inside the field of the another charge, only it can able to experience a force. But when the charge is placed outside of this whatnot charge, it never experience a force. That means the charge must be placed inside whatnot this region, then only it can able to experience a force. So now I want to explain two charges now. One is source charge and another one is what not test charge. So this we can call it as source charge. This we can call it as not a source charge. So what is mean by source charge? Source charge means the charge which create the field, that we can call it as not a source charge. The next one is not a test charge. Test charge means the charge which is used to find out, or the charge which is used to test whether the field exists or not. For that we need one more charge, that we can call it as not a test charge. Here test charge is a default charge. The test charge never produce a field, it is only used to check whether the field exists or not. For example, this is a magnet. If I say this is a magnet, will you believe me? You never believe, correct? Not? If I say this is a magnet, you never believe that, correct? Not? But if I bring one more magnet very close to the given thing,